Showtime.
Talk to me. Talk to me.
Showtime.
All right, now, let's go. Let's go. Woo!
All right, let's go, buddy, together. Let's go, buddy, up.
Let's go. 60 minutes right
here. Work together now.
Let's go, damn it.
All right, let's go, man.
Let's go.
You want a piece of that championship? Put it in here.
I got something to say.
Bring it up. Listen up.
Don't want to face us. So let's turn up the meat on their ass. They're going to try to run the ball when we're getting third and long. Let's go get them.
We can close the coffin on these suckers right now. Okay? Get your man.
We know we're the best team. Let's just go out and prove it today. We got to play hard. Play within your limits. Let's go out and kick some out of here.
Fellas, listen up. All you ever ask for is an opportunity. You got it today. Where else would you rather be than right here, right now?
Number 75, Brandon Baker. Number 78, John Capel.
safety, Jason Huffman.
Shut him down.
right, y'all, one more time. Here we go again. All right, come on. Put you down. Hold it. Come on. Oh, wait a minute now. Huh. Hey, hey, hey. Yeah, yeah, I know you got soul. Pump the beat, pump the beat. The ball beat, y'all. Shut him down. Shut him, shut him down. Shut him down. Shut him down. Shut him, shut him down.
Thank you. Yeah.
Here we go. Pick up the hammer. Pick up the hammer.
Yeah. time. Here we go again. All right, come on.
We'll be right back. Start at fullback number 45, John Nordstrom. Thank you. stop. Shooting stars never stop.
Shooting stars never stop.
Even when they reach the top.
Here goes the supernova. What a pushover.
Thank you. Thank you. to go, Brandon! Woo! Go Auburn! Go Denny! Woo!
Defense! 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 Yeah! running the wheel. Yes, they are.
Ball's up. Brick.
Yes. We got it. It's ours. Oh, horse manure. 3 seconds.
Forget it. No way.
He's gone! He's gone!
Yeah.
18, bro.
Yeah, what? He's gone. Touchdown.
Tonight, the Cascade Bruins meet the Auburn Trojans in first-round playoff action. The Bruins are coming into this game after a hard-fought, undefeated season, while Auburn is coming in as the third-place team from the South Puget Sound League after beating Puyallup on Tuesday. The Bruins will be out to avenge their 28-21 loss to Auburn in last year's playoffs. But you can bet Auburn will be ready for them in this exciting rematch. Next, on Viacom's Game of the Week.
Hi again, everyone. Well, it's football playoff time, and it's a nippy November evening at Frank Goddard Memorial Stadium on the campus of Mariner High School. Tonight, playoff action between the Auburn Trojans and the Cascade Bruins, a rematch of last year. And as it was noted in our introduction, Auburn won that game in a slight upset, at least. And they'll be up to do the same, out to do the same this year. Cascade will be out to reverse the action. Do you rate it going in?
Oh, this is a tough one. Looking at the pounds and inches out there from Auburn, they are one big team. It's really something when Paul Mickelbart is outweighed 120 pounds.
We'll talk about that a little bit later. Jones, in his fourth year at Auburn, got a highly successful program out in the South King County area. This year, 9-1. Last year, they went 9-3 overall. And last week, they beat Puyallup with their one back, Don Sims, running for 190 yards on 30 carries. He gets the ball most of the time. And we had a chance to pre-record some information from Bob Jones. And here it is as he leads off talking about his key players.
Our key players offensively all year, first of all, have been running back Donnie Sims. Donnie's rushed for over 1,400 yards this year, set an SPSL rushing record, and has been carrying about 26, 27 times a game. So he's probably our most important player offensively. The second person who's done a great job is Jason Torgerson. Jason's a wide receiver, but he'll carry the ball some on reverses and counters and things like that. His reception average is over 20 yards per catch, and he's rushed for almost 200 yards, so he's another factor. Our tight end, Jason Hoffman, has caught 19 passes, and so he's, you know, a factor. But one thing for us, what we found is this year offensively, if we can spread the ball around, try to get it to all of the receivers at least a couple of times during the game, and then let Donnie have his 20 carries or better, that's usually the formula for success for us. Our second year in the playoffs, I think one thing is we're probably not going to sneak up on people this year, certainly Cascade. I think last year they hadn't really seen us a lot, and I wouldn't say that they underestimated us, but certainly when you don't know very much about someone, it's hard to prepare. And we had, I guess, known more about them probably than they did us because of being defending state champions. I think last year, maybe after the half that where they had really dominated us, our kids really kind of set their mind to getting things evened up. And because we were only down 14-7, we were able to do that. This year, as you look at it, we're not going to sneak up on Cascade. I think that they have a film to study of us, as we do of them. But I think that, you know, they had an opportunity to see us the other night against Puyallup, and so they certainly know that we can run the ball. And we're not going to change in terms of things we have to do. We need to run the ball first, and then it obviously set up the pass. And so I think what I expect is that it should be a fairly close game, and that we need to play them in a close game. And if we can do that,
A team that would like to establish the run with number 33, Sims, and then they also have their big play kid in Torgerson, number 3, who can beat you on a reverse or a deep pass or some kind of counteraction. So we have to respect them as a really good offensive football team that last year took charge in the second half and ground out some long yardage gains. So we want to be real aggressive on the defensive front, try to fill gaps, and then not allow them that big play that hurt us last year and then that what they've hurt people with this year. When we're on offense, their linebackers are very effective of running to the ball, really pursue well. We need to stop that with some counteraction of our own. We need to make sure that they don't creep up into an 8 or 9 man line and take away the run. If we see that happening, then we've got to go to the pass and try to break a big play with the pass.
There's Sims getting an opening and into the secondary. It's a race. Heron is after him, and Heron gets him clear down at the Cascade 40-yard line.
Replay, little trap block we see in there. Bring him right up the middle.
Josh Heron
cut him off, though, had the angle on him.
This is Hess giving off to Sims on a delay. Another big hole inside the 30, almost to the 25. 55. There's Sims again, and he's got the first down. Eanes is number 14, closest to your camera, as the wide split man. And there's a counter play. Sims carries it down to the 7-yard line, either side in the slot left. Sims is still the only remaining back, and he gets it again. Good blocking. He should score, and does.
Don Sims takes the handoff over left tackle.
Seven-yard touchdown run. And excellent record this year. Shows a strong leg, and he gets it through the uprights. So Cascade trails 7-0, but I don't think they've seen a drive quite like that all season. Let's see. The line of scrimmage is going to be the 27.
There's the replay. Butler coming from right to left, trying to outrun the...
It's all kicking. Nice punt. Nice punt hanging up there. Oh my, fumbled, but I think fallen on by Auburn. Auburn took it away. Evidently that's going to be the way it is the whole game. Long count. Hess on a delay gives to Sims. Got the first down and more. He's inside the 20. And still, well, he's breaking loose from other tacklers.
has carried the ball 13 times for 112 yards.
Wow. So it's a 23-yard effort, would give his team the lead. It's up, has sure got lots of length, and it is straight enough. It's good. So it's a 10-8 ball game now with Auburn. And it's got a pretty good wall.
Okay.
Across the 35-yard line to the 36. Ryan Dunham, number 6 on the kickoff coverage team for Auburn.
Scissors play.
Is it going to go into the end zone? It is not. Oh, boy. Well, the kicking game has been kind of important. Field position.
Uh-oh.
There's a fumble. Touchdown. The pitch out went awry. Ethan McDonald, number 70.
Well, we're seeing a little bit of everything tonight, Rod.
Third and 11. Hess, straight drop back. Out in the flats, good. Is he going to make the first down? Looks like he did with that big leap at the end. That was the flanker left. Heron wants to throw to him. It's going to let him run under it, but he won't get there. In fact, it's intercepted by Givens, Roderick Givens. Anybody's ball game, but the Auburn
8. Both quarterbacks attempted 7 passes, completed 2. Auburn for 14 yards, and Josh Heron for 31 yards. Sims primarily ran for 122 yards. Cascade combined for 168 yards. Total offense then for Auburn, 136 yards, and for the Bruins, 199 yards. But the big difference in the game and the score so far, Cascade has committed 3 big turnovers.
Here's a second down play. Quick pitch out to Butler. Not much running room. And he gets only a couple of yards across to the 36-yard line. Good stop put on by Roderick Givens, number 1. Also, Troy Larson, number 21, was in there. And we have another third and long coming up here. And off to Butler, trying to go wide. They have him hemmed in, surrounded. Down he goes for a loss. Long count. Hess fakes the draw. Has a man complete for the at the 37-yard line. It's complete to Jason Hoffman, the tight end. And here's the reverse to Torgerson. That's the play we thought was coming, and he's on his way for a first down to the 25. Fake to Sims. Has to pass, rifles it. It's complete to Hoffman. He struggles in for an apparent touchdown. It is. Lead, which means still that Cascade has to get 2 scores to go ahead.
Okay, Hoffman to get the ball. Butler to the left. You see the Cascade blocking pattern, and the young man makes the tackle. If he doesn't, Butler might have had 6 points.
Dobbs, here's Dobbs. Can't get away from a sure tackle in the secondary by number 9, Tyler Waite. Dobbs gets it and goes nowhere. They were really set for that one and knocked him backwards. 3 white shirts were around it. Pettibone was 1. The Troy Larson, perhaps more responsible for it. Wants to pass. It's complete to Dobbs. That's why he was there. That was second down and long, and he got it right. There's Dobbs. Dobbs spilled up on a good tackle. Right coming underneath was number 21, Troy Larson. And there goes Dobbs. Power.
Moving pile.
Yeah, moving in the pile, but he did. Oh, Dobbs has stopped way back. Could not go. Ethan McDonald, man 22-20. A short break here. Back with the final period. Give is to Butler. Second man nowhere. Loss of a yard on the play. Number 78 in on the stop. That's Sean Cottrill and also Troy Larson.
Well, that was the outside belly.
Fake here. Oh, he's going to be hit. Heron is down for a loss, and that good defender, Troy Larson, has been tough all night long. He's a linebacker, only weighs 175 pounds, but he was very quick to the ball there. And as pretty soon we're going to have to start looking at the time remaining. Right now it's 8:45 to go, lots of time. Wide out to the left is McMeans. To the right is Jason Torgerson. Hess gives off to Sims. Sims can't get away. He's stopped at the four, one direction or the other. High snap, but DeBolt has plenty of time. Nice kick again. Dobbs takes it at the 44. Goes down at the 36-yard line. There's Dobbs trying to pick a hole, and there's no hole there. Maybe got a yard. Here's the quick pitch to Torrey Holloman, and they grab him by the shirt and throw him out of bounds for no gain, maybe a loss. Ethan McDonald, who's been a big factor in the game tonight, hung on to him. The Bruins look a little apprehensive. Oh, yeah, it's a half a yard short. So Auburn again takes over in a precarious position, but and now the clock starts in motion. 5:16, 5:15. Hess, the last man into the huddle, number 15 he is. Sims gets up to the 7-yard line. 85 right now and counting. High, should have good coverage. Dobbs takes it at the 48. And can't go anywhere. Stop. Clock shows 48 seconds and counting. Here's the quick pitch. Carrying the ball is Butler. Goes to the sideline. Didn't get out of bounds. Briefly.
10 seconds is all.
10 seconds it is. By Holloman. Heron to pass. Throws the big lob. It's over the head of everybody. Givens defending against Travis Myers. It's lining up at the 26. It'll be a 36-yard attempt by Aaron Torgerson, a very unsure field goal kicker for much of the year. Pringle is the holder. I'm going to try it. He boots the ball, and it went over. No, it didn't. It didn't go over. Final score. As we conclude the season, it turns out, for the Cascade Bruins, Auburn wins it 22-20. We'll take a brief break here, return with some final comments from Tony Whitefield, and look at the statistics and recap on the game.
Next on Viacom's Game of the Week.
Yeah. Programs this year have winning records. The varsity program was the North Division co-champions and got to the state quarterfinals. Individuals and our team set 4 school records and 1 SPSL record. And we had 7 players on offense, 1 special teams player, and 7 players on defense who were honored with some type of all-league recognition. And that's pretty outstanding. In addition to that, we had, of the 4 players of the year in the South Puget Sound League, 2 on offense, 2 on defense, we had 1 on each side, an offensive player and a defensive player. So it's been quite a year. This particular group of kids obviously had a great deal of success. If you look at wins and losses in this particular group, it's something like 25 wins and 6-7 losses over 3 years. That's a terrible record. They, at every level they played at, they had winning seasons. They have all of these all-league things. They've done everything that we could expect of a group. This is for varsity captain, and during the season we have our 2 set captains, Ethan and Steve, but every Thursday the coaches get together. We always like to send 4 gentlemen out there to represent the team. And I don't think once during the course of the season did this name not come up during that Thursday little mini meeting we had. It almost became monotonous, but because of the way the youngster played, because of his attitude, his whole demeanor, and the type of person he was, not just to mention the kind of football player he was, the kids have voted Don Sims varsity captain. Out there every day leading calisthenics and stretching and form running and all that kind of stuff and in the games. And I never had an opportunity to coach, but had a great time with him in the hall. He's in between classes. He's probably one of the greatest artists I've ever seen. He's a Slayer fan, but his art depicts that every game is interesting. I have a little bit of superstition that follows me.
And a
little bit.
Just a little bit. And it seemed like every week he would come to my room and he would either draw some picture of the game we were going to play, the team we just defeated, on my board, and then give me another picture to go to the night of that game. And as we got into the playoffs, they started turning into color pictures, 3D color. And there was unbelievable stuff. But this guy was an inspiration to me because he always put a smile on my face, even when things got tough. Ethan McDonald. The last captain, as was already mentioned, Steve Mattioli. He is an individual that led a lot by actions. We didn't necessarily have a whole lot of rah-rah type stuff, but we had some people that really took care of business. And for 3 years, Steve was an individual who led by example, who worked hard in and out of season, and I think was, you know, just like the other captains, a tremendous impact on our team and really helped us to get to the level that we were at. Steve Mattioli.
The award that I get to give is the Varsity Inspiration Award, and one of the things I think that, you know, most of the people in this room have been involved in the sport before and have recognized someone as an inspirational type player. And so I think when we use that word, we all know what this particular award is all about. This particular person gave us everything that he could give us. He played as hard as he could play all the time, and he did it with a lot of emotion and enthusiasm, and it meant something to him all the time, and it obviously meant something to his teammates. The Varsity Inspirational Award winner, Troy Larson. First time I can give out the ones that are voted on by the players, they're ones that the coaches pick. There are a lot of times people think the coaches' award is, you know, it's kind of like the booby prize or something. It's like taking your sister to prom. And I'm being serious here, guys. You know, we've had the good fortune over the last couple of years to have a number of all-state football players and a lot of all-league selections. And those are awards that are given because of talent, and they've been rightly deserved. You know, I thought about, boy, if you could put those guys together on one team, if we had them all together, would that be a heck of a football team? And I thought about the people that we've given the coaches award to and why we give it to them. And, you know, the fact that a lot of times they're just flat out the glue that holds a particular group or the team together. And that the success we have and that those other players have would not have been possible without their efforts. And I thought, boy, you know, if we had all the coaches award winners, it'd be a heck of a football team also. It'd probably be a heck of a game. You'd have one team out there that looked like they had everything, all the talent, and you'd have a team that just refused to go away and was going to fight them right up till the end and stand there toe-to-toe with them. I'm going to miss this young man greatly. 1993 Coaches Award winner, Rory Foster. Coaches Awards for the Coaches Award this year. This gentleman, a senior, was the kind of kid who did everything he asked, sometimes even out of position, maybe in an area that he wasn't familiar with. He'd say, you know, if you need help, I'll do it. And it's the kind of those little things that you pick up on as coaches, the kind of kid who doesn't necessarily care about personal glory, but is more concerned about the team and the overall family atmosphere that we try to set up with the kids that we have. Again, these are the kids that are the glue that hold the team together. The Co-Coaches Award for 1993 goes to Mark Mariani. Special awards, we're doing the most improved, and it's a very great pleasure for me to announce Jason Hoffman, most improved.
And if I'm going to let me
See what happens when you don't have a read, guys? Usually when you start talking about most improved players, you start talking about young men that were, when you started with them as sophomores, they were kind of a project, to say the least. This gentleman has worked with me in the weight room for 3 years. When Coach Brim and I were talking during the summer, Dave told me that it looks like we're going to have to depend on this guy to help us on the defensive line. I thought, oh my God, that's going to be something to behold. But Brandon did a great job in the weight room, and he's done a great job all season for us. 1993 Most Improved Brandon Baker.
You guys, you had a lot of fun when we had the goal line stand at Curtis. You should have been where we were, and at Camp Meridian. I mean, it was a lot of fun for the people in the stands, but it wasn't as much fun as it was for us. And the win over the Puyallup boys, the coaches drinking coffee in the middle of the field during warm-ups, who didn't take us seriously, and the win at Cascade. Those are things that you guys, especially the players who are sitting in there, we've got nobody else will ever have, ever. And that's what it's all about. Some things that for juniors and sophomores that you need to know. You have one returning starter on offense, and you have two on defense. Sort of tough that with young Pete who got to start one game at the end. There is not a group in the state who is going to predict you to be successful next year with one starter back on O and two on D, but you will. And everybody in here will watch, and they heard it here first. But it's only going to happen if you follow the lead of the people that went before you. If you get in the weight room like the people did this last year, the 29 people that went to camp, all of those things, if you do that, you'll be the greatest.